And welcome to the first episode of Gretchen's Garage. This is my garage here in Pennsylvania. And this is Gretchen. Gretchen is a 5/8 scale German dive bomber known as a Sturzkampfflugzeug, or StuKa for short. I'm not going to go too much into the history of the aircraft itself, the original aircraft itself. There's going to be a small section at the end of this episode that will tell you about that. What I am going to deal with on these episodes is talking about the aircraft itself and how it got here. I guess you'd have to see one of those whirly-giggy, going back in time kind of things to take you all the way back to where this began, and that would be as a boy. As a boy, I enjoyed building models, much like this and this one. When I was sick, my dad used to bring a model kit home, and I would sit and put them together with Vicks Vapo-Rub rags around my neck and to kind of pass the time, and got very interested in the different types of aircraft that were out there. It was also around that period of time that I had desire to fly or wanted to experience flight. I did that for the very first time when I was about 8 years old by crawling out onto the porch roof from my bedroom window. I reached up above my head, grabbed the canvas awning, pulled it from its frame, ran down the little roof, and jumped off. No broken bones, and no one heard about it or even knew about it until years later. But that's when I experienced my first flight. So, model airplanes, the thrill of flight, it eventually had to come to this. So exactly how did that happen? I've been a professional musician most of my life, playing bass guitar in a rock band. Many, many years ago, I authored the band's first website, which gave our fans a way of getting in touch with us directly instead of writing fan letters. Shortly after the site went up, we got fan mail or emails from all over the world, which was amazing to me. But shortly after, a person who lived about a half an hour from here contacted me and asked me if I had gotten my pilot's license. I hadn't really thought about that before, and almost in the same breath, she said, "I thought you would have built your own airplane by now, too." I thought, wait a minute. Here's this person who knew of my desire to fly, and not only is she asking me so many decades after the fact whether I had my license or not, but also if I built a plane yet. I decided to look into it. But before I did that, I literally stood up and walked over to the phone and booked my first flying lesson. I had read about experimental aircraft building in the late 70s, early 80s in magazines like Popular Mechanics, pre-web days. Now I had some technology at my fingertips that I could find out exactly how to do this crazy idea of building an airplane. One of the first things I did was research if it was even possible for me to do that. I found out, yeah, people from all walks of life build experimental aircraft. The second thing I did was to join my local EAA chapter, or Experimental Aircraft Association chapter, chapter 769, out of then based in Riverside, Pennsylvania. There is a wealth of knowledge in experimental aircraft chapters all over this country and Canada, all over the world for that matter. Our particular chapter had a lot of people who had built aircraft and had flown them, and I started doing some data mining of my own. One of the most informative things that I learned was that there were controls in place for someone like me, someone who was enthusiastic about building an experimental aircraft, but didn't necessarily have all the knowledge, you know, in place at one time. I could learn as I went. There were controls behind that. In other words, the aircraft had to be inspected. It had to be signed off before it could even move on the ground or in the air. And that was possible by way of a DAR, or Designated Airworthiness Representative. Let's go back to the fan of the band for a second. Her father was a veteran, an experienced pilot, a home builder or a builder of experimental aircraft, and he was a DAR. He was also a former engineer from Piper Aircraft. She suggested that I get in touch with him. I contacted Paul and asked him the feasibility of doing this, of this project, the way I wanted to do it. We'll talk about those building methods in a later episode of Gretchen's Garage. But I ran it by him, and he jokingly in the beginning said, "Why would you want to build a kraut flying machine?" Because that was the plane that I wanted to build. He looked over my my notes and said, "Yes, definitely. The way you are planning on building this, in my opinion, go forth and build." We sent measurements, dimensions, numbers back and forth, off and on for about a two-year period before one piece of wood was cut. Before we started sending anything back and forth, I asked Paul if there was anything that he would change on the aircraft, and in his words, he said, "Jeff, I wouldn't change a damn thing. The original flew. This is basically a smaller model of it." However, one thing he did insist on changing was the airfoil of the wing. The airfoil is the shape of the wing over which passes and under which passes the air to generate lift. The wing on the original StuKa was a symmetrical airfoil built for combat, built for speed, although the StuKa was not very fast, but built for combat maneuvering and speed. What he suggested, because I would be, in his words, flying around the neighborhood, was a very high lift, low drag, very friendly stall speed airfoil, which was the USA 35B. This is the section of the wing, the outboard section of the wing. But this is what the airfoil would look like and the airfoil that he suggested. I agreed with this reasoning completely. To be honest with you, I hear a lot of people joking about the StuKa and it was a truck in the sky and everything else. I don't care if this thing moves at 70 miles an hour. I just want it to fly. So that didn't really bother me. I agreed to it because, quite frankly, he said he wouldn't help me if I didn't, and he wanted to see me safe. And that's how we proceeded. So we've come to the end of the first episode of Gretchen's Garage, the Hintergeschichte, or the backstory of her creation. In future episodes, I will talk specifically about the design of the aircraft, the methods that I use, the building materials that I use, and we'll do a walk around the aircraft. Don't forget the historical section at the end to give you more about the original StuKa and its development. It's just a short history at the very end, but what? First, a word from our sponsor. Pennsylvania's finest. Prost.